far as my history in the industry, I started our company in 1990. I am a member of ASTM. I've probably only been a member of ASTM for probably the last 6-7 years. So if you ask me what ASTM was prior to that, I would have threw my hands up in the air and said, I really don't know either. Fortunately, I go through the training in the state of Pennsylvania. I am a licensed Pennsylvania State Amusement Ride Safety Inspector. They have a unique program in Pennsylvania where it's based on education and not on revenue and getting a license and actually, you know, paying fees to the state. And I want to make that distinction as well. ASTM is a voluntary consensus standard. It's voluntary. A lot of the states adopt these regulations as law. Then it becomes mandatory. So if you're pointing fingers or getting upset with people, get upset with your state before you get upset with ASTM or any of the other governing bodies that kind of put these things together. I do present at the Pennsylvania Ride Safety Seminar annually. They have two sessions. I really like their program because it's education-based. You take a test in Pennsylvania. It'll cost you $50 to take the test. The seminar is every year. But you need 16 hours of continuing education as an inflatable inspector and 24 as an unlimited inspector where you can do hard rides and things like that. You have the knowledge, you have the education, you have the brain power to then self-inspect your equipment. They still have the oversight, the ability to audit what you're doing, check up on you, review your processes and make sure it's being done right. But that costs you $50. I'm from Ohio. Cost me close to $18,000 to be in compliance with the state ride safety licensing and inspection. I know there's guys that'll complain about $50 per inspection. It's reasonable to me. I'd love to get back to that point in Ohio. And I talked to a gentleman that was in Florida, said that they're going to inspect every location and every site when you set up. It could very well get to that point. I'm here to push back and try to prevent that from happening because I don't want to see it either. First of all, it's not feasible. It's feel-good legislation where they think this is going to work, but who's going to do all of that? How many events are in a given Saturday or Sunday? How are the inspectors going to get to every event? It's impractical. It's not going to work. And I would push back to every state legislator that there would be that wants to see that happen. As it's impractical, it's not going to work. So that's where you can come together as a voice and kind of band together as an association. We do have an association we started in Ohio, so Ohio Inflatable Operators Association. Texas has a similar group. It's an advocacy group. We push back to our state legislatures to try to manage our fees and do practical regulations versus knee-jerk reactions that just cost us more money. Common misconceptions about inflatable amusements. These things are great big soft pillows and nobody can get hurt, right? I mean, we'll just lock them in there, let them play, nobody's gonna get hurt. We'll just let the kids play, adult supervision isn't required, they can drink margaritas around the pool and everybody can just have fun and nothing's gonna happen. On a nice day, I don't need to anchor these units. The things weigh a ton, nothing's gonna happen, they're not gonna blow away. Plus, I'm gonna take it down in 2 or 3 hours, so why go through the extra effort of staking this down when it's just gonna come down right away? So them are common, maybe misconceptions of the inflatable industry that lead to the accidents that continue to occur. ASTM is an internationally and globally recognized leader for the development of voluntary consensus standards. There's 12,000 ASTM standards in existence today. They exist for the quality, enhance the health and safety, strengthen market access and trade, and build consumer confidence. ASTM regulates baby strollers. They regulate now bounce houses. And not necessarily, I'm using that inconsistent. They don't regulate, they develop standards to allow you to voluntarily comply with the standards. They're best practices. They're things that are gonna keep you from getting into trouble should the worst case scenario happen. This is your F2461 subcommittee on adventure attractions. That's one of the things that was developed in this whole process, adventure attractions. They're different from amusement rides. There are amusement ride standards. I'll refer back to that. And they do apply to the inflatables, But we have our own standards that's separate from the amusement rides because they are different. And we'll talk about the development of the standards and how that specifically applies to the inflatables. Mike is the task group co-chair. That's his email address. Phil Slager is the subcommittee chair. I work with Phil on a lot of things. Kathy Fackler is a consumer advocate from saferparks.org. If you'd like to write that website down, saferparks.org. And I tell you what, when I first started on the committee, I was intimidated. I thought I was going to be intimidated by Kathy. She's a consumer advocate, right? She's against us. She doesn't want to see bad things happen to people, and she wants to make sure we're in check and make sure we're not doing bad things to hurt kids. Kathy is the most unassuming individual that I've found. She's the most knowledgeable individual. She's helped out on this committee so much, and she's the most reasonable individual that I've dealt with that really was an advocate to not only the consumer, but an advocate to our industry that said, hey, this doesn't make sense. We shouldn't do this. And kind of helped us fight on a few things. So I give Kathy a lot of kudos and an applause for her stance. And she is a very knowledgeable and intelligent lady that really has driven a lot of this stuff forward. Katrina Capernaum is the ASTM staff manager. She's the person that you would contact at ASTM if you have a question and you want to know something about the standards, what you're supposed to request, or what committee you want to join, and things like that. Timeline for the development of the standards and where we're at today. The current standards was approved on February 1st, 2010. So we're approaching 2018, so we're 8 years old on anything that's been done with the standard. The standard originally was approved in 2004. Nothing was basically done with it since then, since 2010, which was minor revisions, grammar, and just very few things. It was about 10 pages long on the long side. The new standard is going to be about 38 to 40 pages with the revised content. In November of 2014, there was a meeting held at IAPA. There was a lot of people in the room. And that's when these task groups were kind of assembled. People were approached. I can tell you that Mike, I don't even know how to say his last name, Butang or whatever, he's from Canada. He was an engineer, task group chair. I was approached by Phil Slager to be the task group co-chair for the owner operators. I reluctantly and hesitantly started. And Kevin Baldry here is a co-chair as well, because I told him, I don't have time for this. It's voluntary. I don't have time for this. I got to run my business. I've got to go back to Ohio and make sure I get my own stuff taken care of. But if busy people don't step up to help, who's going to do it? It's kind of been my whole motto for pressing through this whole thing. If you don't step up to do it, who's going to do it? And we need more people to step up to help. So, you know, I ask you to help. In February of 2015, they had the ASTM F2461 winter meeting in Fort Lauderdale, and that's when all of this started to get pushed forward very aggressively and started to take shape. There was a lot of work done prior to that with standards being written. I took the Pennsylvania safety standards, the New Jersey standards, what we do in Ohio, and the ASTM standards that existed already, and kind of meshed all them together and threw it into the blender to try to have all these guys analyze it. And we talked about it and kind of developed the standards that we have today that I think is very well written and should be very well received by the industry. The proposed standards currently under review have not been received by all their approvals, and consensus standards is done through voting. If somebody doesn't agree with something, they vote negative. And it needs to be addressed before we move on, and it's not pushed forward until everybody agrees. So that's been the whole process here, where, you know, a lot of things have been debated intelligently. And I tell you what, there's been some stupid ideas thrown out there that have been totally ridiculous that still had to be disproved and talked about. It's been a lot of heated discussion. I can tell you that Bob Fields and I had some frank discussions sometimes too, and you know, a lot of times it was passionate because we believed in what we believed in and we wanted to do certain things. So there was, I'm not gonna lie, knocked down heated arguments in these rooms that this isn't right or this needs to be done. Yes, and Kathy was a referee for a lot of them and kind of kept people from crossing the table. So there was a lot of passion put in these standards. The scenes that continue to create the necessity for these standards is scenes like this. This actually occurred in Ohio with the slide blowing away. And you can kind of see right here too, that's a kid. You know, you've seen it on the news. You've seen it on the USA or US Today Show with, or Today Show, what's the other one on ABC? Whatever it is, I don't even watch the news anymore. Good Morning America, there you go. You know, the whoever the guy is that does the investigative stuff and stuff. You know, so that's the things that happen. And the big driving behind this, that organization right there, US Consumer Product Safety Commission. There are certain things that we didn't want to see happen, but I tell you what, we had no choice. Because these guys want it to happen, and what they want is what they're going to get. And if we don't agree to it, it's going to be hard for us to even do business. This is the big part right here. NEES data. National Emergency Room electronic data, it basically, everything that happens, but there's 13 deaths between 2003 and 2014. Just related to bounce houses. I have them documented. I have them in my binder here. I'll talk to you about them later. 2,852 injuries from 2008 to 2013. These are the things that are real. These are the things that we had to address and say, this is why we need to develop standards to make these go down and make that death toll get to zero. What we do has an element of danger to it. It's adventure attractions. We don't strap people in an amusement ride and have them go around in a circle. Unfortunately, what we do is we say, hey, go in this bounce, venture through the obstacle course, get on this joust, get on this bungee run, you're free to roam, but we're trusting you not to get hurt. So there is a patron responsibility part of this that we put in there and stuff too that holds them accountable, and there's certain things we can't control. I mean, there's gonna be incidents, there might be accidents, but how we do things is going to make that happen less. The CPSC Amusement Ride Safety Bulletin was issued in August 2015. If I go back to here, you can see we had our meeting in February of 2015. We were trying to beat them and prove to them that, hey, we're doing things as an industry. You don't need to step in right now. But unfortunately, in 2015 of August, later on that year, they stepped in. They said, hey, you're not doing it fast enough, you're not doing enough things. So they issued this Consumer Product Safety Commission's bulletin, which is not copyrighted material. You can Google it, and I encourage you to do so and read what it says. Know what it says, and know what they're holding you accountable to do. So, you know, Google that, you can download it, it's available, you should have it, you should be aware of what's in there. Scope for the ASTM F2461 Adventure Attractions is the practice established to criteria for design, manufacture, installation, operation, maintenance, inspection, training, auditing, and major modification of commercial use inflatable amusement devices. Devices are made of flexible fabric, inflated by one or more blowers, and rely upon air pressure to maintain their shape. They are designed for patron activities, and they may include but not limited to bounce, climb, slide, obstacle courses, and interactive play. That's directly from the proposed standard. Amusement rides covered by this standard are used primarily in amusement entertainment or recreation applications, such applications include, but are not limited to, amusement parks, theme parks, water parks, family entertainment centers, rental companies, fitness centers, gyms, gymnastic facilities, jump centers, sports facilities, skate parks, camps, schools, shopping centers, temporary special events, carnivals, fairs, festivals, and municipal parks. Pretty sure going through that list, that includes everybody in here. They wanted to make sure everybody was included. Exclusions to the standard. Inflatable devices marketed directly to consumers for private home use by children. The ones in Costco, the ones in Walmart. These devices are covered under a separate consumer product safety specifications, ASTM F2729. That's not our committee. We didn't make them standards. They're a constant air inflatable play devices for home use. That's that ASTM F2729, separate committee, consumer use. Inflatable devices that are used for professional exhibition or stunt work, safety or rescue activities, aerial or aviation structures, exhibit floats, or similar inflatable devices, basically used for emergency medical purposes, things like that, they're not covered under the standard. Inflatables that do not have floor affixed to the inflatable structure. So if you don't put a floor, it's not inflated, it's not covered under the standard if you're a manufacturer. Inflatable devices that require a sudden loss of air to perform their intended function. Stunt bags, inflatable impact attenuation devices. You know, the stuff that are used in the professional industry there are excluded. Inflation devices are designed primarily for floating devices to be installed on inflatable or on bodies of water. So the things you see in the ponds are not regulated by our standards, are not included with that. I know you see them in some of the camps and the activities and other things like that. They are excluded. Highlights for the manufacturer: the design requirements for the inflatable amusement devices shall be in accordance with practice F1159 and the exceptions and inclusions of unique inflatable amusement devices. Replace the term amusement rides and devices with inflatable amusement devices. What this statement says is we're still under the regulations of F1159, which is amusement rides, but this is in addition, and this is inflatable specific. What they've done, here we go. Parts of an inflatable device have been defined in our standard to further explain how we do business and the way these things operate. The definitions include obstacles, a platform, for instance, a platform on the top of a slide, playing area, ramp or step, run out being the end of a slide when you're coming down, the deceleration area before you hit the bumper, containment wall, which had a lot of deliberation and a lot of things changed with containment walls, meaning that how do you keep people in the inflatable so they don't fall out and crack their head open on the concrete? How do we keep them in there? What is the height of that? What should it be? What should it be made of? And what should it be? Where should it be on the inflatable? And impact attenuation is another thing. When you're coming in and out of an inflatable, how are we to control that so that you don't fall down? And impact attenuation mats, said it three times. Remember that, it's the biggest part of your standard. Wind, specific maximum wind speeds and the type of anchorage. We've kind of had a lot of a heated discussion on this, and wind is going to be a big factor because you've seen so many things blow away. A lot of it's how you install things, and we'll get to that. So, but specify maximum wind speeds and types of anchorage. An analysis for determining the acceptable anchorage system shall be performed and stamped by a licensed professional engineer. ASTM standards are requiring engineering of your inflatable devices. That doesn't affect you so much, but it does affect the manufacturers. And there are certain things you should be looking for at IAPA, if you're going down to IAPA, that you should be looking for here from manufacturers to make sure they're ASTM compliant. And these things are going to be, you know, kind of good to go for several years down the road. You'll start seeing there's a lot more of engineering standards put into the standards, where you're going to see graphs, charts, illustrations, and a lot of these things, like I said, from a manufacturer's point of view, there's going to be some engineering that's going to be needed to be done. Stake anchoring standards. Correct? Incorrect. There's a false, I guess, belief out there that you got to put a stake on a 45 degree angle. It's going to have more holding capacity than a stake put in at a 90 degree angle. Totally wrong. Totally proven wrong by science. Totally proven wrong by the studies that they've done. The stake anchoring provides staking recommendations and information on pullout capacity for a 1-inch diameter straight shaft stake based on the stake length, stake inclination, the guy angle, and the soil consistency. soil consistency is something that varies from Arizona to Michigan to Ohio to Pennsylvania. So a lot of these, we can tell you what state to use, but it's going to vary based on the soil consistency. And the way this standard was crafted in the end started out one way and ended up a whole nother different direction because of that. If the stake anchoring system is designed using other stake types, it doesn't mean that they can't be used, but it doesn't need to be in compliance with the pull-out capacity. Non-stake anchoring, where the inflatable amusement device is anchored with other means of ground anchors, be it ballast bags, sandbags, water anchors, weights, indoor floor anchors, drilling them to the floor, the total anchoring system shall be sufficient to resist the loads calculated by the manufacturing testing. That comes with from your manual. You should have a manual from your manufacturers when you buy an inflatable. You should require it. You should get it if they're in ASTM compliance. Highlights for manufacturers continued here. Some of the things that are in the standard that were talked about, entrapment of head and neck, you know, clothing and hair. Entrapment of clothing and hair, you're thinking, how can that occur? Velcro, hook and loop. You know, hook, the Velcro can no longer be, you gotta have a cover over it if it's gonna come into contact with people that are playing inside of the device. So the finger entrapment, you know, areas in the game where you can break fingers and things like that, body entrapment. I mean, these are just cases that were documented through NIST data that were addressed by engineers to say, hey, you know, there's a certain design standard that these need to be manufactured to, and them standards are in this new revised publication. Containment, again, there was deliberation by the engineering committee and the manufacturing committee, but how high do these need to be? How high do the walls need to be to keep people in from falling out? Impact attenuation, I'll get into that in a slide here in a minute. And then emergency exits. Emergency exits have been put in the standard. If you've got a bounce, you need to have an emergency exit other than the door in case of deflation. If you do not see an emergency exit in the top of a bounce in this next go around IAPA, I would talk with that manufacturer and say, hey, you might want to start taking a look at the ASTM standard and become familiar with it, because they should have a zipper, Velcro, whatever it is on the top of the bounce, and be labeled emergency exit. Ingress, egress, and device landing surfaces, we'll talk about that a little bit now in a future slide here. And this is just the graphic to kind of demonstrate. Ingress and egress is the entrance and the exit to your bounce, or to your obstacle course, or to your slide. And these are just three common examples of how you're going to have to use impact attenuation matting around the exits and entrance. Right here's your mat. You've got one entrance, one exit. You've got to protect this area 4 feet around from any entrance or exit points. So 4 feet this direction, 4 feet this direction from the center of this exit. Same thing here. You've got 2 points on an obstacle course. You got the entrance, you got the exit. Standards require that you're going to have impact attenuation matting on each end of your obstacle course. Same thing with the slide. 4 feet area from the front of the slide, impact attenuation areas that are going to need to be provided by you as the owner, operator, possibly by the manufacturer, but it's not required from the manufacturer. That's where we get into ancillary equipment. Ancillary equipment for a manufacturer is the blowers, the air, whoever, ground fault interruption, GFCI. Most of the time, if you're connecting these to a house, by code, they need to have GFCI on their outdoor receptacles. But if you're plugging into an indoor receptacle, it may not be a GFCI protected receptacle. And it is required in the standard that you now use the ground fault interruption. Deflation alert system, one of the most controversial and one of the biggest parts of the standard that really upset me the most. And we've got a lot of that. We protected our industry as owner operators. We got a lot of this squashed back down. There's a little bit of it left in there, but a lot of it has been taken out. You'll be very happy with the results of that. It's not going to cost you the thousands of dollars that it would have had it went through the way that it was initially proposed. Impact attenuation materials, start looking at matting. Ask the mat manufacturer if it's ASTM compliant and has been impact tested. Don't waste your money, don't make a donation to that company if it's not been done, because it's going to need to be done by the standard. Permanent labeling is going to be required on all the devices to be ASTM compliant. It's going to look a little bit like this, and I know it's not real big that you can see it, but it's going to have the maximum number, maximum weight, maximum height, minimum weight, minimum height, blower size, total number of people participating at one time on that activity. All of that information will be on the unit. There will also need to be safety labeling and directional labels, but there will also be some safety labels on there that I have. Wind rating, about staking it down, and then a warning to the people using it are going to be required. But the safety labeling and directional labels, when I mean directional labels, safety labeling is what you see on the bounces now, and the bounce house manufacturers have really cleaned that up to be kind of a standard already without even having a standard. You know, what are you supposed to do? No flips, no rough housing, take your shoes off, all of the safety stuff you see on the bounce. But now you'll maybe start to see some directional labeling. Directional labeling would be sit when you slide. And it's going to be at the point of reference. You know, if you're supposed to duck under, go under. It'll tell you to go under, it'll tell you to go over. It'll tell you certain things within the inflatables. You may start to see that. And then operating instructions, the manual. The manufacturers have been tasked with a lot of extra things to do that they should have been doing already to be in compliance with the standard. And a lot of that goes into the manual. You know, you gotta know what you're supposed to be doing to be able to do it. So you need to have that manual. Deflation alert system. This is something I was adamantly against and adamantly campaigned against to try to make reasonable. I will tell you there was some CPSC pushback on this too, and it was going to happen either way. We just needed to make it tolerable for our industry. So where deflation alert systems are used with inflatable amusement devices, the deflation alert system shall incorporate one of the following. An automated means to monitor the onset of deflation and alert the operator or attendant, or B, an automated means to monitor the loss of blower function, and a supplemental means to allow operator or attendants to monitor other failure that can cause rapid deflation as a result of the adequate air support to maintain the structure of the inflatable device. This started out as an alarm, and it was balloted as an alarm. There's only one system out there that is deflation alert system that is an alarm, and I don't believe in it. It's the watchdog. And I think there was motives that pushed this forward that basically were self-serving and a profit motive. So we basically took a look at this and I said, hey, it's not proven. So why should we have to go out and buy a $200 watchdog blower system for all of our blowers? I have over 30, 40 blowers that I would have to replace this on, $200 a pop. That's not gonna be fun. So here, this is all. So we'll get back to the deflation system. But owner-operator highlights, the owner-operator shall develop a program with necessary tasks and training to operate, maintain, and inspect the inflatable amusement device. What you need to do, write these down. I encourage you to do so. The program shall include, but not limited to, you're going to get a head start, an operations program. How do you operate your business? How are you going to operate your bounces? How do your employees know how to do that? A maintenance program. How do you make sure these are safe for the next use? How do you make sure that they're maintained throughout the year? How do you maintain that they're going to continue to be in operation for 3 and 4 years down the road? An inspection program. Pre-opening inspections. Before you open each bounce, you should have a pre-opening inspection program in place with documentation to prove that you're doing that and that you're going to be in compliance. Some states require it already. Some states don't. Training program. What is your documented training program for the employees within your company? How are you going to get bigger? I know some of you may be one or two person operations. Some of you may be three or four or five or 10 people operations. But what kind of training programs do you have? And as an owner operator, you are required to develop the materials. Patron education. How are you educating the patrons and the people that are participating on your bounces of the misconceptions that we kind of went over at the beginning of this presentation? That's not the case. How are you providing them with rules? How are you providing them with other educational materials so that they understand the safety that needs to be applied to use and operation of these bounces? So development of that documentation, signage should already be taken care of that by the manufacturer. You just communicate it to the patrons. Environmental conditions, you know, doing an assessment of the areas where you're operating and understanding weather conditions and the wind and in adverse weather conditions, whether it be rain, snow, lightning, whatever it may be, and having a plan in place to address them that it's not going to be an issue. Patron education and patron responsibility. Again, we talked a little bit more about that. Here, this is the deflation alert system. You could get this at Cutting Edge Creations. It was developed by Cutting Edge Creations. It was developed and it got a patent on it. I'm not totally sold on this yet. I think there's other ways of doing it. So therefore, the task group decided to phase in a mandatory requirement for use of deflation alert system in order to get me choked up on this, because it got me choked up at the beginning. I'll tell you, at the beginning of this, you were required to buy these. You were required to buy them. You were required to put them in on every blower that you had. That's ridiculous. So that's what we fought to push back down and get out of there and not have. So we did have a victory as owner operators in this room of engineers and manufacturers and people pushing this agenda forward. So we were successful in that. But we're going to basically phase this in, and this isn't dead yet, but it's going to give owner operators a chance to use the device on a limited basis and give the inflation alert market time to an incentive to mature, so that manufacturers and the owner operators have a chance to develop this for different cases and different uses. The initial requirement applies to new designs of inflatable devices with elevated platforms. That's what we got to push back to. If there's an elevated platform, and I believe it is like 25, or I think it's actually, I think it got pushed back down now to 8 or 10 feet. But if there's an elevated slide, for instance, these will probably be required. It's not approved yet. But we got that removed from every inflatable to just the standard where it's a slide or something with an elevated platform. It may come to be a broader use, but we're going to fight vehemently against it to try to limit that. Basically, wind is the enemy. And wind is what we got to address. If you have staff not staking down inflatables, fire them. Get rid of them. You don't need them, we don't need them. So, I mean, we've got to start doing things right. Inflatable amusement devices shall not be used when the sustained wind speed is in excess of the maximum wind speed specified by the manufacturer. Installers and operators and attendants shall be trained on how to monitor and assess the wind conditions using an anemometer, Buford scale, or other reliable method. We didn't put in there as a standards committee just saying, hey, you need to buy an anemometer to be able to do this. We used a thing called the Buford scale, and this was suggested by some smart people that basically there's ways of just looking into trees and things. I'll enlarge this in a second. But in the event that the manufacturer of the other inflatable amusement device has not specified a maximum allowable wind speed for operations, the owner-operator shall use 15 miles per hour. That's come down from 25. So if it's not engineered and you don't have the manual and you don't know, 15 miles per hour is now your standard. Or maybe it's got to be approved. This is the Buford scale. You can pull this up online, kind of see. But basically at 19 to 24 miles an hour, where you should be thinking about tearing a bounce down. It's a strong breeze. Large branches on the trees are in motion. whistling can be heard in the wires or through the trees. Fresh breeze, 19 to 24 miles an hour. Small trees begin to sway. So using a flag, using trees, using what's around you, the conditions to kind of assess the what needs to happen. Pull-out capacity of stakes. Hogan was nice enough to donate these to me, and we're going to use these on some presentations. Initially, when the standard started, this was the stake that we were looking at using as a specific stake in the standard. It's 18-inch, 5/8-inch diameter, 18-inch long hook stake, driven all the way into the ground and buried. It can and will be an acceptable use if it meets the standards that the manufacturer set for the inflatable. Most of the staking studies were done using this bad boy right here. It's a 1-inch stake, 30 inches long, double-headed. And we'll get into pull-out capacity here in a second. All right, the material in this section is derived from a 3-year staking study conducted by the Civil Engineering Department at the University of Illinois and commissioned by the Tent Rental Division of the Industrial Fabrics Association International, IFAI, TRD. We did not commission our own study on this. We used a stake is a stake is a stake. A stake does not discriminate what it's holding. Am I right? A stake, when you put it in the ground, anchor it all the way down, the holding capacity is going to be the same as it's holding an inflatable or if it's holding a tent. So we kind of borrowed some of these standards from the tent industry because they already were done. And I know you can't see this back there, and I apologize, but this goes into the different length of stakes from 40 inch, 36, 30, 24, and I can't read that either, 18. Soil conditions. And this is where you have variations. If you're on a beach in Miami, soil conditions are a lot different than in the clay of Georgia or the crop fields of Ohio or the Rocky Mountains of Pennsylvania. So there's hard, basically soil conditions of hard, very stiff, stiff, medium, and then hard. Your pull-out capacity diminishes based on the size of the stake and the soil consistency. And it's very blurry, so I mean, I can barely make it out myself on that. So, but this is a staking study that was done by the University of Illinois, and the way the standards were developed. And basically, you're going to get your staking standards from your manufacturer. So they're going to tell you what stake you got to use and how long it needs to be. The impact attenuation test method that was used, and this wasn't going away. No matter how hard we fought, and no matter how hard we wanted to disagree with it, this was not going to go away. It was a CPSC issue. But the mats that you're going to have to purchase or buy and use, you know, with your bouncers, the landing area shall limit the G-max peak acceleration to less than an average of 100 when a representative sample is tested in accordance with the test method at 3355. A 20-pound missile. The missile drop height is at 30 inches, and it's performed 3 times, and the average of them drops are then calculated, and it's got to be 100 pick value or less to be in compliance. There are mats that can comply with this, and they're not big, thick, 6-inch mats. Look to the gymnastics industry, look to the wrestling industry. They do have some pretty good mats out there that are needing to be developed to maybe apply to the inflatable industry, but the mat industry is going to be evolving over the next 2 and 3 years, and you're going to see a lot more mats. But ask if it's impact attenuated or impact tested before you buy it. Otherwise, you're making a donation. You're buying somebody's junk. Use of the impact mats, I had this slide up earlier, but you know, basically this is how it's going to apply to your operation. needs to be 4 feet from the entrance in all directions to be in compliant with the standard. How thick it's going to be is going to be based on how it's manufactured. There's different materials they use. It could be 1.5 inches, could be 4 inches, depends on the materials you use. Again, there's some wrestling mat manufacturers out there, Dahlemer, Resolite, I'm trying to think of some of the other ones. Them are the two main wrestling mat manufacturers that I'm aware of, because I have a background and work with wrestling and stuff as well. But it can be done, and they're not going to be these big, cumbersome mats. I think we're going to end up with some things that are pretty user-friendly. They're not going to be heavy. They're easily transported. And I've actually talked with Resolite already, saying, hey, you know, let's get ahead of the game here. You guys stand to make a lot of money on these mats, but hey, let's make it practical as well, because we need to buy a lot of them. So let's figure a way to make this affordable for us. So basically, on some of the issues we just talked about, comply or complain. You can sit with your arms folded and say, I disagree with all this. I'm not going to listen to it. And that's very well your right. They are voluntary standards. But when an injury happens, when you're going to get insurance, when you're being deposed by plaintiff's attorney, I suggest you understand the standards you're going to be held accountable for and be able to answer questions intelligently. And let's face it, it can happen. So it allows you to market safety to your clients as well, being knowledgeable in the ASTM standards and basically being in compliance with the matting standards, being in compliance with the deflation alert system. But you can develop your business around these standards so you don't have to have a knee-jerk reaction. Be successful in developing and being ahead of the curve and differentiating your business differently than the competitors down the road. Basically becoming a better inflatable company that's insurable by the limited number of insureds that we have out there now that's even taking our business. Membership dues to join ASTM are $75 a year. I do have a paper up here, and fortunately I have enough for everybody in attendance since there's not a whole amount of chairs being occupied here. I'll lay them on the stage here. You can take them if you want. Sort them. But again, membership is $75 a year. I'm going to tell you as an owner-operator, if $75 is really important to you, and you think that's too much money to spend for a standard, go to the bookstore, buy some business books, buy whatever it is, and ask them if you can take it for free. They're going to ask you to check out, and they're going to ask you for some money at the end. There's a lot of people, including myself, including Kevin Baldry, that put some money in this, and we didn't get paid to do it. We did it voluntarily. And if you want to jump in, jump in. The standard's probably going to be published beginning of the year next year. Pay $75, get the standard, and then exit. Don't even renew your membership. I don't care. I'm not an ASTM advocate. I'm not paid by them. So, you know, they're a good organization, and I think you should be a member. But get the standard. And you can become a member by visiting ASTM.org. And as I described it earlier, there's a lot of engineers in a room. It's not the most exciting party that you want to go to. They're very much into statistics and standards and stats. So they're not very customer service friendly at ASTM a lot as times as well. When you become a member, you'll go through the process online here. And my website is ultraparty.com. That's my company website. I have a blog there. I just put it up on Monday. And I put a step-by-step process for becoming an ASTM member with screenshots and everything, and what committee, F24.61, where you've got to check them boxes, because it was difficult to me when I did it, and it's confusing. So there's a step-by-step process on my blog, which is on ultraparty.com. You can print it out, and it's ASTM standards, I think is the title. It's right there. I just put it up like Monday. So you can go to my website, ultraparty.com, and then go to ASTM.org, and you can do everything online. Remember, sometimes our customers are their own worst enemies. People want to agree with me on that statement. They ask you to do things regardless of the standards that are unsafe. They ask you to put stuff on concrete when you've got 5 feet away from you, you've got a nice yard that you can stake it down into. Advocate of staking. Always stake if you can use a stake. I'm not an advocate for sandbags. And if you look at your manuals, it's going to be very hard to comply with the weight that you're going to have to anchor these things down with to be in compliance with that. Always act in the best interest of safety, and then sometimes it's better to just say no to certain things. That's hard for us to do sometimes. I know we all want to make money. We all want that job. We all want to do things, and when you're asked to do things that are unsafe, sometimes it's difficult to deal with that customer. And you got to kind of run that scenario through your mind. How are you going to react? How are you going to respond? What are you going to say? So basically, this is a quick overview. I encourage you to become a member of ASTM. The standards, there's a meeting on October 11th through the 13th. I'm going to go out there because I want to see this thing through. And I want to see the standards voted in. If there's anything that comes up midnight hour, we're going to be there to represent the industry and say, hey, we don't agree. So, but let's continue to influence safe operations and continue to build safe and sustainable business. This thing's cutting in and out. My website's ultraparty.com. We have started an association as well. It's the Ohio Inflatable Operators Association. We're very safety-based. We're a highly regulated and inspected state. It costs me $18,000 a year to be in compliance with the licensing and inspections in Ohio. I don't want that for you. So get involved and become an advocate for the safety and the regulations and the standards in your business to be able to respond in advance and not after the fact. It'll help. I was asked a question here, we were in discussion here right before this seminar. Don't confuse ASTM with legislative issues because they're two different things. They said this was going to be mandatory that everybody's going to have to be inspected in Florida before every operation. And that's not an ASTM initiative. That is a state of Florida legislative initiative, if in fact it's true and if in fact it's going to happen. In Ohio, we started our association to basically lobby and be an advocate for safety and regulations and work with our lawmakers to make sure that that doesn't happen and it doesn't get any more out of control than it already is. I would like, through our association, to be self-regulated in, say, maybe 5 years. We're going to have a safety conference once a year for training, and we're inviting the state there. And we're inviting our lawmakers to come and look in on us and say, hey, we're doing this based on the ASTM standards. We're proactive, not reactive, and we want you guys to get out of our pockets and stop charging us for all these things that we know we can do ourselves. So that's some of the things where ASTM is very advantageous to you, to be knowledgeable in your industry, be knowledgeable in the standards, so that you can be proactive in addressing some of these legislative issues that are going to be coming up if the accidents continue to happen. So, any questions? Correct. The only way I can tell you that it would not apply is if you had that surface impact tested, and none of us can afford one of them impact testing missiles, or we could, but it's going to be not something we're going to carry around with us. So the playground standards, you'll notice underneath all the commercial playgrounds, they have that rubber surface or they have that mulch. That's been impact tested, and that's probably in compliance with the standards with what we're at. But we don't have that luxury. I mean, you gotta do it every location. Grass, concrete, blacktop, whatever it is. Indoors, you know, and that's really the site assessment you should be doing, like in here when we got the concrete floors setting up inside. You should want, as a responsible operator, to put them down. It's up to you if you do it in a yard. You know, I can't tell you how to run your business, but I can tell you what the standard is. Any other questions on that?
You're talking about go to IAPA and look at bike bounces and
Good question. The question was, what happens with my inventory that I already have if it's not compliant with ASTM standards the way they're written and might be published in the spring? There's, I guess, two answers to that question. Do you have a manual? Now, a lot of us may not have manuals, and if you don't have a manual, then the new standard applies because you don't have documentation from the manufacturer of what you should be in compliance with, you know, whatever the standard was at that time. So, you know, it's good to have manuals. You should have manuals. A lot of us don't. I know there's stuff, older stuff that I have that I don't have manuals for, and I'm stuck. So I'm just going to have to be in compliance with the new standards. Yeah, it allows for grandfathering, you know, but again, it only allows for grandfathering if you have that manual. If you don't have the manual, then, and you don't know who the manufacturer is per se, maybe, or, you know, they're out of business, then you're on the hook. I mean, you're going to have to be in compliance with the ASTM standards. Any other questions? Ask me about some of the ancillary devices, the deflation alert system. Hey, what about the deflation alert system? That was huge that we don't have to buy, if you got 100 blowers, that you don't have to buy 100 watchdogs. And that's what it was starting out to be. So, you know, luckily we only got to buy some mats now. And but we could have spent a whole lot more money, and that's where we had a victory in all of this as owner operators. You know, pretty much everybody wants this to work. And we're to a point now where all the arguments are done. And it's understood now that, you know, this is for the best advancement of our industry to do things right and ultimately have insurance 2 or 3 years down the road. So, and I think this will all help us out insurance-wise. We will have to, they are going to phase that in, but the watchdog blower system is only going to be used where that platform is, I believe it's 8. I think it started out 25, then it went 10, and now it's, I think it's down to 8 in the standard. And that was a compromise. And that's on a lot of these things. It's the only way we're going to get along is if we compromise. And I think it's to a good point right now. So it's acceptable. So that may come, you know, and let's address it as an industry. You know, and hopefully there's more associations and a primary association representing owner operators that is developed that'll allow us to then, you know, kind of address them issues as a whole rather than having individuals just complaining. And the EPA website or EPA Facebook is great. You know, it's great to kind of share ideas on there and stuff too. I know there's a lot of complaining that sometimes goes through there. You know, you're gonna have that. But there's a lot of good information that's on there too. And you know, if you see me comment, you know, I'm gonna comment on ASTM standards. I'm gonna comment fact versus fiction versus not just my opinion. So I try to be middle of the road on there. So I do get sarcastic sometimes because that's my nature. So. It is annual, and I'm not sure if they go from when you when you get your membership to when a calendar year, or if it's they'll prorate it if not. But jump in right now. It's the best $75 you're gonna spend. Yeah. Go to my blog and go to ultraparty.com, and there's a sheet that you can print off there. I didn't want to. It's like 8-10 pages because it's step by step and it's very detailed because we wanted it that way. So and I wasn't going to print it for everybody. I figured that was the best way to do it. You can print that. Yeah. What there's 12,000 standards. So this will take you F24 is our committee, F24. Then you have all these individual numbers in between there, the 1995 for the amusement rides, and you know, that's where it gets confusing. I don't even have it all committed to memory, but that's where that sheet will help you out in getting your registration done. So. All right, any other questions? Because I want to get out of here too. It's 3:30, I think, right now. Yes, so that was an hour presentation. You know what? This stuff is absolutely boring. Thank you for sitting through it. I enjoyed it that we were able to be part of the process and represented, but these meetings were absolutely brutal. I mean, sitting in a room with you know, debating all this stuff and going over it. And, you know, I hate reading this stuff to you guys, but that's what the meetings were. And it was, but I think we're to a good place. You know, I think it's going to do a lot of good in our industry, and I think we're, now it's a standard. It's the way everybody should be doing it. Whether they do it or not, that's to be determined, because they are voluntary. But hey, let's be the voluntary part that's doing it and influence the other people to kind of follow suit. So thank you. You guys are the most ambitious people. You're the most hardworking people. You're the most safety conscious people, because you're still sitting here and you're still kind of going through this. There wasn't a huge amount of people come through this conference, because it was only guys that are concerned, like me, like you, like everybody else. So kudos to you for that. And when we get together in IAPA, there will be an update meeting at IAPA. Look at schedule, come to the meeting. You'll meet Michael. He'll probably give most of the session. I'll be part of it. But there'll be a lot more to discuss there too, because we will be going through that meeting in October. So again, thank you. That's all I got. I know it's boring, but it's necessary. And take it home with you and distribute the need